Hi, my name is Sarah Dobson, and today I will be teaching a lesson on musical directions that's geared toward a sixth grade general music or choir class. And it's targeting the standard, the National Core Art Standard, or the Missouri Music GLE, or grade level expectation, for understanding connections, and the number for that is MU, and then it's connecting CN11A.6A. So the strategy that I'm going to be using is a strategy for building vocabulary in the classroom across content areas, and is known as concept cards. So this instruction fits into the overall lesson because in the overall lesson I would begin class with this 15 to 20 minute mini music theory lesson, and then I would point out the appearance of these musical directions in our music pieces and incorporate them into class discussion throughout the remainder of the rehearsal. So how does this fit into the mini music lesson? The instruction fits into this lesson in particular by giving me a platform to show students that there are more to musical terms than just a baseline understanding or a rote definition. And it simultaneously creates a useful tool for independent study and self-testing. So this students will benefit from this instruction because most flashcards just use the term and the definition on the other side. But these concept cards include the most important aspects of what is involved in having a deep understanding of these concepts. So we're going to start, and I will model the strategy. So on the board, I drew an outline of what the concept card strategy looks like. So on the front side of the card, which is the blank side, you have your superordinate idea, or like the overarching topic, in the upper right hand corner. And then if you'll put your targeted word or the vocab word that you'll be defining in the center of that card. And then if you flip it over to the back of the card, the line side, you will want to number the lines 1 through 4. And if you have like big handwriting, or you know it'll be a long definition, I suggest you skip lines. But number 1 is going to be the definition of the term. Number 2, you're going to use some characteristics and features. Number 3, you're going to cite a personal example or any example using that term. And then number 4, for our purposes in this lesson, we're going to draw the symbol that corresponds with that term. So I'm going to model the first example using the vocab word staccato. So I would write our lesson topic in the upper right-hand corner, which I said at the beginning is musical directions. All right, and then I'm gonna write the targeted word staccato in the center of that front card. Okay, and then if I were to flip to the back of the card, I would start with number 1, the definition of staccato, which is music performed with each note sharply detached or separated from the others. So I'm gonna write that down. Perfect. And then number 2, we're using the characteristics. So the characteristics I could think of for the word staccato are that it's Italian for detached. So I'm going to put detached in quotations. Another one I thought of is that it is an articulation marking. It affects the rhythm of the music. And then finally, it's the opposite of legato, or like smooth, connected rhythms. All right, moving on to number 3, an example. So the first example I thought of when I thought of staccato music was the Scaramouche section in Bohemian Rhapsody. So I'm just going to play a clip of that really fast so you can hear it in context. All right, so you can hear obviously in that passage how the music is very choppy and detached. So I'm gonna write that down, just the Scaramouche section in Bohemian Rhapsody, and that'll help me remember what staccato sounds like in the context of the music. And then finally, for number four, we're going to draw the symbol for staccato, which basically, depending on the way the stem of the note is facing, you either put the staccato, it's just a dot that goes right under the center of the note head. So I'm going to draw both directions. If the stem of the note is going up, then you put the staccato dot right underneath it, like that, and if the stem is going down, then you put the staccato dot right above it, like that. Does everyone understand the strategy? Okay, so now we're gonna try to do one together. So I'm gonna hand out this handout, and it has the outline of just what you include in the strategy, and also the example that I just did on the board. And then I'm going to hand out some note cards for you to practice the strategy. Perfect. Okay, so the vocab word that we are going to use is da capo al coda. So we're going to write this on the board. It's the same superordinate idea, so you can go ahead and write musical directions in the top right corner of the blank side of your note card. Okay. And then we're going to write da capo al coda in the center of that card. So. Da capo al coda. Perfect. And then you can flip it over to the line side. So for number one, we're going to do the definition. Does anyone know the definition of da capo al coda? Yeah.
When you go back to the beginning and play until the symbol telling you to go to the coda.
That's perfect, yeah. So we're gonna write, you repeat from the beginning, or the capo, and then to an indicated place, which is indicated by the coda symbol, and then you play that tail part, which is known as the coda. Alright, so for number two, we're going to go over some characteristics or features of the term. So, first of all, it's Italian for from the beginning, or literally from the head. So you can write down that translation. And then it's usually abbreviated as capital D, period, C, period, alt coda, to make it a little shorter when you're seeing it in sheet music. And then also another characteristic I had is that it's a repeat direction, which basically just means that it tells the musician where to go back in the music. Okay, can anyone think of an example of a song that goes back to the beginning and then takes a coda? It's kind of hard to think off the top of your head, but if not, I have an example I can play. Okay, I'll play. The example I thought of was Hey Jude by the Beatles, where it returns to the very first verse, Hey Jude, don't make it bad, and then it goes into the fade-out coda with like 4 minutes of the na-nas, so I'm just going to play that part really fast. That was just an example so you could hear the structure of that term in the context of the music. So next to number 3, I'm going to write Hey Jude by the Beatles. Hopefully that'll be a good one for you to remember too. All right. And then for the last one, number 4, does anyone know what the sign for da capo alt coda looks like?
It's a circle with a like plus sign.
Yeah, in the middle. Perfect. So we're gonna draw that under number 4. I'll draw it pretty big so you can see. Yeah, it's basically like an oval, and then you basically draw a plus sign or like a cross through it. And that's what you see. You'll see probably the abbreviation DC alt coda in the sheet music telling you to go back to the beginning. And then when you play until you see this symbol, and when you see this, then you jump to the coda at the very end. All right, so now that we've done one together, are you ready to try one on your own? Okay, so the one that you're gonna try independently, you're gonna use the vocab word pianissimo. All right, you're both done. Okay, so for the number 1, can anyone give me a definition for pianissimo? Yeah.
Very quiet.
Very quiet or very soft. Yeah, perfect. So I'm gonna write that in next to number 1. And then for number 2, does anyone have any characteristics for pianissimo?
It's a dynamic marking.
Yep, it is dynamic marking. We can write that. And then another one I had was that it's even quieter than the dynamic piano. And piano just means soft instead of very soft. Okay, for number three, could you think of any examples of like pianissimo music, very soft music? Mm-hmm.
Like lullabies that you would sing to babies to get them to go to sleep?
Yeah, that's what I thought of too, like just very quiet, soothing music. So you can write lullabies. Again, the last two examples we did, I did a specific song, but if a general like genre or type of music helps you remember that term, then you can certainly use that too. So we're gonna write lullabies next to number three. Okay, and then does anyone want to come up to the board and draw the symbol for pianissimo?
I will.
Okay. Then draw it next to number four. Yeah, perfect. So it's like two italicized lowercase p's is what it looks like. So that's the gist of the concept card strategy. This strategy is not a standalone assignment. It would be part of a larger assignment in which the students would continue to add concept cards as we would come across new vocabulary in our music. And then these cards would be studied in and outside of class in preparation for our unit tests. So finally, I would assess whether this strategy was effective or not based on my students' performance on vocabulary-based questions on my unit exams and other assessments. Thank you very much.